Welcome to a very wintry Dunblane and Dunblane Cathedral as our Advent journey continues. Throughout Advent, we have heard the words of the prophets, especially Isaiah, pointing beyond the troubled times they inhabited to a new age dawning, when the world would encounter God in a new way, especially through the birth of a little child who was to be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Today, as we draw closer to Christmas on this last Sunday of Advent and remember the birth of Christ, we think on two of the people upon whom the fulfillment of prophecy and the birth of Christ will have the most direct and potentially devastating impact. There is Mary, who has been chosen to bear the child, and Joseph, to whom she was engaged. But before we turn to the story of Joseph in particular today, the story of the birth of Christ, as told by some of the young people in Dunblane, in words and music, will form our online nativity for this year. So come, let us worship God. Hymn 319 of the Father's Love Begotten. Wait for the Lord, his day is near. Wait for the Lord, keep watch, take heart. Let us pray. In this fast, impatient world, we're not good at waiting, God of all time. We crave tomorrow's results today. We fail to cherish the possibilities of each moment. We rush headlong on, when we should be looking around us, watching, noticing, listening for the signs of your presence and your touch, of seeing the need of those who travel along with us, often whom we simply pass by. We're not good at waiting, God of all time. Too often we do not use the waiting time well, looking, reflecting, pondering, learning. Instead, we doze and we miss the moment, or surround ourselves with a comforting frenzy of busyness. We leave too little time to notice or drown out the cry of this world's poorest people. We create our own little world, with too little time for others, too little time to share their rejoicing or their pain, and with no space at all for you. So let us this Advent find it an awakening time, God of all seasons. Let it be a time of slowing down, of noticing, of looking more carefully, of listening for the voices we often miss, of appreciating the beauty that is usually lost on us, of pondering again what your coming among us can really mean. Lift up our heads, O God, that whenever Christ comes among us, we may be ready, watching, eager to greet him, fit for the company of such a man of peace, ready to be part of his body in this world, so that we will be ready to greet you, to worship you, to serve you, to rejoice at your coming. In Christ's name we pray, as we say together the words he taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And let us listen to the Christmas story told to us once more by Cathedral Kids.
Into the everyday life of a small town called Nazareth, and only for the eyes of a young girl, an angel appeared in the blaze of a light. His presence was unexpected, overwhelming, terrifying, but the girl Mary stood her ground and listened to his message from God.
She learnt she was special, chosen to have a baby, the Son of God. She heard she was to call him Jesus, that he would be the Messiah the prophets had spoken of for so long. Mary was amazed. What message could she send with the angel to God? What could she say?
She said yes!
The girl might be at ease with the news, but the man she was to marry was not so sure. So, the angel visited Joseph in his dreams to reassure him that he should care for Mary. His questions answered and doubts dispelled, Joseph cherished Mary as the baby grew inside her.
And so it was that, not long before the birth, they were called to Bethlehem to be counted for the census and to pay their tax. Joseph cared for Mary on a long journey and searched tirelessly to find a place for them to stay when they reached the crowded city. It was there that Mary gave birth.
Once in royal day, they sing, tune, star shone in the darkness of the Bethlehem night. Its bright beams lit a stable in the crowded town, and in that stable, cradled in a manger of hay, lay the newborn baby.
The star had been sent to light up the stable because the baby was special. He was born of God's love for the world, a sign of love, and a bringer of love, hope, and peace.
Away in a manger, no crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus lay down his sweet head. The stars in the bright sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay.
The star drew attention to the great event, but it was God's messengers, the angels, who told people what really happened. They appeared in great throngs, praising God and singing, "Glory to God on high."
In the quiet of the night, shepherds were looking after their sheep in the fields around Bethlehem. Suddenly there was a great light, and the angels filled the air with song. To their astonishment, an angel spoke to the shepherds.
Hurry to Bethlehem, where you will find God's special gift of love. A star will lead you to a stable where a baby has been born. He is God's son, Jesus, who will be the light of the world.
Full of curiosity, the shepherds hurried into town and found a stable lit by a star.
When the shepherds saw the baby in the manger, they were filled with love and wanted to give him a present. But what could they give? A lamb, perhaps? Maybe a sheep? They were not rich, but they could give them what they had. Love, friendship, a kind word, a hug.
Thank you. The shepherds were not the only visitors to that stable. The star was so bright that it could be seen in lands far away, and some wise men took an interest in it.
The star shining over the stable enticed some wise men all the way from the distant eastern lands to Bethlehem, a journey made in hope and faith that they would find a new king. It led them directly to Jesus, where they opened their treasure for him. For these visitors, expensive gifts were no problem, and they brought Jesus gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Like the shepherd, the wise men offered their gifts with love.
Does the star of Christmas shine for us today? Will we notice that star in the midst of all our busy preparations? And if we do, will we follow its light?
When we let Christmas into our homes this year, how will it be?
Our front doors promise a welcome as jolly as its holly and ribbons, but will we welcome a stranger along with all our friends?
And the refugees amongst us who are so far from home and feeling sad, will we share our Christmas joy with them?
The postman's bag bursts with the heaviness of so much greeting, but will we think about those who are lonely at Christmas?
In our houses, the Christmas trees patiently bear our bells and baubles, but there are people who don't even have a home, let alone a tree to stand in it.
The adverts tell us what delicious treats we can have, but there are some who will struggle to afford food to eat at all.
The television blares out its message of family fun, though for some families there is sadness of being apart, and fun belongs to another time.
For Christmas with love, say the labels on the presents. Perhaps you cannot afford presents, and like the shepherds, love is all you have to give, but that love is a rich gift.
We cannot pretend that Christmas will be lovely and cosy for everyone. We think of those who struggle to pay for the essentials, such as heating their homes and buying enough food, let alone all the other extras many of us expect at Christmas. We think of those who are far from home just now, and especially the people from Ukraine who are living in and around Dunblane, hoping and praying for peace in the country they know and love. This will be a tough Christmas for many people. A Bible verse from the Gospel of St. John's, often quoted at Christmas, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it." It tells us that when sad and difficult things happen, and some people declare war on others, and some people become rich at the expenses of others, those things don't have to have the last word, because other people are kind and generous and step up to help, like Jesus, who is sometimes called the light of the world and never stops loving the world and its people. They too are the light in the darkness.
So, does the Christmas star shine in us today? When we've eaten our Christmas dinner, opened all our cards and presents, and sung our carols, is that it, finished? Or have we a light we can shine in the darkness, the light of love?
Thank you.
Let us listen for the word of God as contained in the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 1, and reading from verse 18 to verse 25. Now the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man, and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of Mary, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. Amen. Stories about children in Sunday schools portraying the nativity play over the years are legion, especially when things go wrong, and especially when the participants decide to go off-piste or are actually encouraged to think creatively for themselves, making up the script as they go along. One example I like went a bit like this. Joseph knocks on the door of the crowded inn in Bethlehem. "Hello, innkeeper," said Joseph. "Do you have a room for the night?" "No," said the innkeeper. "We don't have a room. Can't you see that we're full up? There's a notice in the window saying, 'Full up.'" Joseph responds, "Yes, I know you're very busy, but we've been on a very long journey, and Mary is about to have a baby." innkeeper. Well, that's got nothing to do with me. Joseph. No, that's got nothing to do with me either. Over the years, I have reflected on Mary on a good number of occasions, on her surprise at learning that she is to bear the Son of God, on her sheer courage in daring to say yes to this call of God upon her life, which is a pretty large and devastating one. I've reflected on occasion on the sheer cost of that saying yes to God, and on the challenge that being the mother of Christ brought to her, not just then, but throughout his life. However, I cannot recall really saying very much about Joseph, to whom Mary was engaged. And I think Joseph deserves more attention, more understanding, and I think more admiration than I have given him in the past. For it doesn't take a whole lot of imagination to conjure up what sort of conversation Joseph and Mary must have had when she revealed to him that she was in fact pregnant. Shock must surely have been followed by suspicion on Joseph's part, perhaps a degree of recrimination. Nor does it take much imagination to think what rumours must have begun to circulate within their village when knowledge of Mary's pregnancy began to circulate. After all, you can't hide a pregnancy forever. There must have been some who assumed that Joseph was the father, and you can imagine the comments about him. Who would have believed that of Joseph, him being so righteous? It just goes to show. And there will have been some who would have assumed that somebody else was the father. I wonder who Mary's been playing around with behind Joseph's back, some might have asked, going on to say he'd be better without the likes of her. But to hang with rumour mongers, irritating though they might have been, it is better to ignore them, despite the supposed authority with which they would like to think they spoke. It's always good not to join them in passing the rumour on, however tempting rumours may be to pass on. Matthew tells us nothing of the emotions or of the awkward conversations between Mary and Joseph or of the gossips. After all, he's writing a gospel, not a gossip column, and he's not working for Netflix. All we're told is that when Christ's mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband, to be Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned, we're told, to dismiss her quietly, discreetly. We may not be told much, but what we are told actually says, I think, quite a lot about Joseph. He was a righteous man. He was prepared to wait until marriage before they lived together, giving Mary, who was probably only about 12 or 13 at the time, therefore pretty young, time to grow up a bit. And he may have assumed that he didn't really understand, we assumed that he didn't understand the nature of Mary's pregnancy at first. He might have suspected there was somebody else and would have been consumed with anger, and in an attempt to clear his own name, exposed Mary to very public rejection. And some may well have argued that this is what justice for Joseph demanded. Clear his name, get rid of Mary. But Joseph went beyond what many would have deemed to be just. We talk a lot about justice in our society, but this is an illustration of what being just doesn't come close to dealing with the real problem. Justice suggests that this young girl should be exposed and humiliated. After all, the penalty for adultery for the woman was death. It probably wasn't actually enacted as a sentence very often, but there would have been a very public humiliation of her. Joseph, to be exonerated, and no doubt with some financial accommodation, made to recognise the damage done to his well-being and reputation from public disgrace. That would have been just, in a sense, But what if Joseph actually still loved Mary? What if he was jealous for her, not as a piece of property, but as the love of his life? And what if he didn't stop loving Mary, whatever she might have been up to? No money or public humiliation could give him what he really wanted. And what he wanted was her. All I want for Christmas is you, as the song goes. Now, justice is an important word in our society, but I wonder how often all our striving for justice still fails to give us what we really want. Joseph decides not to clear his name by exposing Mary to public disgrace, but quietly he intends to break off the relationship. And those in the know might have dismissed him as a fool, but he demonstrates a quality that can be lacking even in our quest for justice, and that quality is mercy. How many of us, when we look at our own faults and foibles honestly, have the integrity to recognise that we all, at some time or other, stand in need of mercy? Hence the traditional prayer of confession. It's a prayer for mercy. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison. Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. And yet, sadly, churches can sometimes be one of the last places that people expect to see mercy. And I fear sometimes that the judicial processes in the church are sometimes stronger on discipline than on mercy. Perhaps Joseph, in his attitude towards Mary, has a lot to teach us. But even if Joseph did away with Mary and broke off the relationship quietly, that still leaves Mary in a very vulnerable position. A single woman, an unmarried, pregnant single woman, would be highly vulnerable in that society. What if her parents also rejected her for the shame she was allegedly bringing to the family name? Even doing away with her quietly wasn't altogether entirely merciful, although it's better than a public humiliation. But Joseph does a wise thing that most of us would do well to emulate. He doesn't rush into his response, he doesn't rush into his decision, but sleeps on it. And it is in sleeping on it that he dreams and learns from the angel that there is much more to this tale than he must have thought when he first learned the news. He learned that there is indeed a God-given dimension to this tale that he could never have imagined. Mary is in fact telling the truth. This child is conceived of God. It's part of God's purpose. As I say, however quietly he'd broken off his relationship with Mary, she still would have been highly vulnerable in a society and culture that looked with little favour upon unmarried mothers. But moreover, he would have been missing out on what God was doing. For with God, as Joseph was to discover, there is always an element of surprise which calls for going beyond what others might deem to be reasonable or credible. Like Mary, Joseph will discover that his life will never be completely normal anymore. He too is caught up with what God is doing through Christ. The story of his marriage, his family life, is never simply his own. This will not be, in a sense, his son, but his godson. And he accepts his story as going to be part of what God chooses to do in this world in sending the Christ child to be among us. So Joseph deserves more attention than we often give him. He has much to teach us about justice, about justice that is tempered by mercy, and much to teach us about what it can mean to accept that what God is doing in this world can turn our life and our expectations upside down as well. Good old Joseph, he deserves our imagination and our respect. Let us pray. God of surprises, God of Mary, God of Joseph, God of unexpected intimations of your presence and your purpose, we thank you for all the people who dare to say yes to your call, those who have overcome their doubts and their qualms, those who have allowed their lives to be turned around in order to serve you. We remember those called to ministry and those currently training for ministry in the Church of Scotland, those who teach them, those who encourage them, those who travel beside them. And we pray for all who minister within the church in ordained ministry, in the diaconate, or as readers and youth workers, pastoral carers. And we remember Christian people throughout the world who face persecution for their faith in Christ, and pray for Christian communities in the Middle East, in Pakistan, Nigeria, Afghanistan, and wherever Christians find themselves persecuted for their faith. And we pray too for those times and those Christians who can become the persecutors themselves. As we rush toward another Christmas, we pray for the ability to pause, to watch and to wait, lest we miss the cry of our God, the wonder of a child, in the need of the homeless person, in the despair of lonely people, in the pain of those who are bereaved, in the bewilderment of the refugee. Let us remember the song of Mary, comes true, that the lowly be lifted up and the hungry be fed with good things. We pray for those who mourn at this time, especially through the tragic death of children in Solihull. Let families stunned by tragedy find themselves surrounded by support and understanding, as so much has changed for them, and they know that life can never be quite the same again. Come among us, Christ the Son of Mary, with a challenging word to the powerful, with a comforting word for all who weep, with hope that endures all things. And in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Hymn 291, When Out of Poverty Is Born.
Thank you.
Go forth into the world with the courage of Mary, with the mercy and patience of Joseph, with the light that the Christ child brings. And may the blessing of God, wise Creator, ever-present Son, and lively Spirit, rest upon you and all you remember and love, now and always.